Hello dear students, welcome to EPG Paathshala. I am Dr. Surinder Kaur, Professor, Khalsa College of Education, Ranjit Avenue, Amritsar. Well students, today we will discuss about the topic Federalism and Decentralization in Educational Administration and Management. The objectives of the topic are to acquaint with the term Federalism in Educational Administration and Management, to know about Decentralization in Educational Administration and Management, and list the importance and pattern of Decentralization in Educational Administration and Management, and last one is explain advantages, shortcomings and latest trends of Decentralization in Educational Administration and Management. As India enters the 21st century, education as the master determinant of development has assumed exceptional importance. Universalization of elementary education is the focus of the Right to Education Act and implemented in terms of the constitutional amendment, which has also been made childhood care and education, which is pre-primary education, a directive principle of the state policy. India as a participant in the world knowledge economy is required to revamp its higher education participation rate of the relevant age group population, but also scaling up its research capacity and research output in terms of scientific papers and patents. Thus, all stages of education from the nursery stage to the nuclear research stage have to be emphasized simultaneously. Education under Indian Constitution is a concurrent subject in which both the center and the state can legislate. Educational performance in India, which would determine India's economic performance, is therefore crucially modified by center-state relations. Education through Indian federalism is therefore of vital importance, but rather it is the neglected arena. Meaning of federalism? Federalism is a form of government in which power is held partially by a central authority and partially by a number of regional or state governments. A system of government in which power is divided between a central authority and constituent political units. Advocacy of such a system of government is termed as a federalism. Part 11 of the Indian Constitution defines the power distribution between the federal government, the center, and the states in India. This part is divided between legislative, administrative, and executive powers. The legislative section is divided into three lists, that is, union list, state list, and concurrent list. Unlike the federal governments of the United States, Switzerland, or Australia, residual powers remain with the center as with the Canadian federal government. Concurrent list contains of 52 items like education, contracts, civil procedure, adulteration of foodstuffs, drugs and poisons, economic and social planning, trade unions, labor welfare, electricity, newspapers, books and printing press, stamp duties, etc., etc. Over the years, since independence in 1947, there has been a shift in the process of educational planning from centralization to decentralization, from macro planning to micro planning, and the district has been accepted as the most appropriate unit of planning. The 73rd Constitutional Amendment provides for transfer of the responsibility for primary and secondary school education to the elected bodies. Consequently, there is no uniformity in the manner in which local bodies have been involved in school education across the states. While in several states, a vast scope of function is assigned to gram panchayats at every level, in practice, the gram panchayats discharge few education-related tasks. The Central Advisory Board of Education set up a committee on decentralized management in 1993 to formulate guidelines on decentralization in education in the context of 73rd Amendment. It also proposed creation of standing committees on education at different levels, assigning comprehensive powers, functions and responsibilities to these bodies. Now we will discuss what is decentralization. Decentralization means transfer of power, responsibility and authority to the people at large. It is diffusion of power into the hands of people. India, being a land of villages, our parliamentary democracy must reach the rural masses. Our democratic organization is to be built on rural foundations. The whole outlook of rural population is to be developed by the concept of decentralization so that leadership grows from below. The underlying philosophy of decentralization is to make our democracy, which grows from roots and which is not imposed from above. The reason for the failure of certain democracy was obvious from the fact that their foundations were not firm but unstable. That means democracy was not working properly in practice. Democratic decentralization of educational administration means that schools must become the concern of the community if they are to be organs of nation's life. Our educational institutions should be of the community, should be governed by the community, and should be managed by the community. The system of education must provide relationship of forces from village school to the university. Ignorance can be eliminated by pooling of our educational resources over a network of fabric woven upward from village school as a base. Democratic decentralization of education should run on a parallel line along with the decentralization of other aspects of life of the nation. As Article 40 of the Constitution of India reads, the states are directed to take steps to organize village panchayats and give them with such powers and authority as may be necessary to enable them to function as a unit of self-government. Now, objectives of decentralization. Shri S. K. Day says, Panchayati Raj, as we now visualize, will therefore mean progressive increase in competence from ground upwards and corresponding transfer of responsibilities from the center to the ground. Devolution of authority, progressive delegation of powers, and democratization of administration all along from the center to the family are the ultimate objectives. Broadly speaking, the Lok Sabha should be the cumulative reflection of Gram Sabha. Let us discuss about the system of Panchayat Raj. The Balwant Rai Mehta team on community development programs had recommended a three-tier system of Panchayat Raj. It is a pyramidal structure, village panchayat being at bottom, Jila Parishad at the top, while Panchayati Samiti is to be served as the intermediate agency. The report recommends, so long as we don't discover or create representatives and democratic institution which will supply the local interest, supervision and care necessary to ensure expenditure of money upon local objects, obey with the needs and wishes of the localities, invest it with adequate power and assign it to appropriate finances. We will never be able to evoke local interest and stimulate local interest in the field of development. The pyramidal structure of the three-tier system of Panchayat Raj. The pattern of Panchayat Raj administration is a three-tier system consisting of village panchayat at the village level, panchayat samiti at the block level, zilla parishad at the district level. Importance of decentralization. The implications of democratic decentralization of educational administration expounded by several educationists reveal the importance of this reform. These can be discussed as such. First of all, the self-governing democratic units stand as a guarantee for democracy by providing proper protection and by developing democratic practices in education and by testing the democratic process. It facilitates proper participation in the institutional activities and in gaining the confidence and support for their efficient functioning. Next is, democratic decentralization of educational organization is meant to safeguard education function from being misused through proper control. The task of decentralized educational administrative machinery is to bridge the gap between the state and the community and help in better implementation of plans of educational development. Now, pattern of democratic decentralization of educational administration. Democratic decentralization of education is not of recent origin in the sense that local bodies were assigned the task of administration of education even during the British period from the last century itself. Local bodies were associated with administration of primary education. The district boards and municipal boards were administering both secondary and primary education in the past. In the post-independence era, the Balwant Rai Mehta committee had visualized the system of Panchayati Raj as a mean of democratic decentralization. The entire administration for the purpose of development was to be handed over to this three-tier system, namely the village panchayat, the block panchayat samiti and zilla parishad. Almost all the states of India are adopting more or less the same pattern with perhaps minor changes in the classification used. In all states, the panchayat samitis are statutory executive cooperative bodies except in the state of Jammu and Kashmir, where there are purely advisory bodies. Panchayat samitis and education. Consequent on adoption of democratic decentralization in the form of Panchayat Raj, the responsibility of primary education has been shifted to Panchayat Samitis by making Panchayat Samitis block as a unit of administration of primary education. The state government intends to bring the administration and primary education, which almost constitutes mass education, closer to the people and ensures their direct interest and participation in it. Educational function of the panchayat samitis is carried out with the help of standing committees for education. The act mentions the standing committees for education has to perform educational functions also. For every panchayat samiti, there shall be a standing committee respectively for education including social education, medical relief and health sanitation. It is stated that for standing committees under clause 3, at least one woman and one scheduled caste representative should be the members. The Standing Committee for Education assists the Panchayat Samitis relating to education for maintenance and expansion of elementary and basic schools like management of government and taken over aided elementary and higher elementary schools, establishment of adult education centers and adult literacy centers, provision and improvement of accommodation for schools with people's participation, taking of such action as may be necessary for the promotion of education for all children until they complete the age of 14 years. Among the administrative personnel of Panchayat Samitis, the extension officer's education is concerned with the education wing of the Panchayat Samiti. He carries out specific functions like inspection of primary educational institution and looks to the improvement of their educational standards. Zilla Parishad and education. With respect to education, the Zilla Parishads are concerned with the establishment, maintenance and expansion of secondary schools mainly. Educational functions of Zilla Parishad is carried out through the assistance of Standing Committee for Education. Standing Committee in the Zilla Parishad administration is related to education, medical and public health. The Standing Committee is responsible for the improvement of education. Now, advantages of decentralization of education, and these advantages are as such. It enables adjusting the institutions to the local needs and environment. They become the true replicas of community life. Second is, it facilitates community leaders to accept the responsibility and share it to a desirable extent in the educational programs and implementation of educational plan. It is affecting necessary sociological, political and economical changes in the rural sector, and a new energy is vital in the rural areas. It has brought about the awareness of the great weapon in their hands, that is vote. Establishment of Panchayat Raj in general had helped to provide ample opportunity for politicians of the rural people. Decentralization relieves the top executives of the burden of performing various functions. Centralization of authority puts the whole responsibility on the shoulders of an executive and his immediate group. Decentralization ensures better control and supervision, as the subordinates at the lowest levels will have the authority to make independent decisions. As a result, they have thorough knowledge of every assignment under their control and are in a position to make amendments and take corrective actions. Decentralization brings decision-making process closer to the scene of action. This leads to quicker decision-making of lower level, since decisions don't have to be referred up through the hierarchy. Now, latest trends. This stresses the need for educating the emerging leadership of rural areas in democratic values and practices to enable them to carry out the functions which democratic decentralization places on their shoulders efficiently and effectively. Shri Jay Prakash Narayan, the president of the 4th National Convention of All India Panchayat Raj Parishad, visualized establishment of Pradesh Panchayat Parishad and National Panchayat Parishad, making a 3-tier system as a 5-tier system by upward extension on the same. This, coupled with the dream of World Panchayat Parishad by Shri S.K. Day, makes the system a 6-tier, one consisting of village panchayat, block panchayat samitis, district panchayat parishad, State Panchayat Parishad, National Panchayat Parishad and World Panchayat Parishad. Improvement in democratic decentralization of education. To maintain the present mode of democratic decentralization of education in an improved way, there are certain suggestions like there is a need to define clearly the powers and responsibilities of deputy secretaries education in Zilla Parishad. For this purpose, it is essential to appoint only trained graduates for the said post. They should be able with full powers necessary to carry on their functions relating to the educational wing of the Panchayat Raj. Experienced educationists and retired educational administrators should be associated with education under the Panchayat Raj by taking them into the Educational Standing Committee as the members. Alternatively, district advisory boards of education may be established to replace the standing committees associating experienced educationists, retired educational administrators, headmasters of schools, office bearers of the teachers' organizations, and members of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha of the district. The powers of appointment, transfer, control, and discipline should be vested with the district educational administrators only. District selection committees should be formed under the chairmanship of the district educational administrators as to facilitate recruitment of suitable personnel for the teaching and administrative positions associating prominent educationists and other experienced educational administrators. Teacher welfare committees should be established in each of the Zilla Parishad to look to grievances, amenities and housing problems of school teachers. The chief function of the non-official functionaries should be categorically delimited to the educational expansion programs such as providing of equipment, apparatus, furniture, accommodation for schools and schooling staff, midday meals, etc. They should be given only reviewing and advisory powers, leaving executive functions to the departmental personnel. To have the academic inspection of the Zilla Parishad schools, there should be some special educational inspectors under the administrative control of the district education officers. The extension officers should be placed under the administrative control of these education secretaries. Suitable education should be given to the non-official functionaries of the Panchayat Raj who have to deal with education in a planned manner so that they may be able to carry out executive functions properly. Problems and possible solutions. Many problems have cropped up as a result of democratic decentralization of education, which demand immediate solution. Now the problems, it has not attained the desired goals. The community participation is not so encouraging. Improvement of management and supervision of schools has not taken place. On the other hand, dual governance is felt. The supervision of education department over the educational wing of the Panchayat Raj is unsatisfactory. Teachers are drawn into politics. There are frequent transfers of teachers on grounds other than administrative, resulting in the deterioration of educational standards and discipline in schools. There are possible solutions also. First one is, there is need to define clearly the powers and responsibilities of the educational administrators and the non-official functionaries. Teachers should be kept away from politics and occupational security should be provided to them. the deputy secretaries should be redesignated as the educational secretaries of the Zilla Parishad and should be vested with adequate powers. The extension officers should be placed under the control of education secretaries. Educational Standing Committee should be formed as the advisory bodies of education at the district level to help in the development of education in the district. The powers of appointment, transfer, control and discipline should be vested to the district education officers only. Non-official functionaries should be given administrative training for a short time. District selection committees should be formed, including the district education officer, Zilla Parishad chairman, to look into recruitment and training of the teachers. At the end, education under Indian Constitution is a concurrent subject in which both the state and center can legislate. Federalism is a form of government in which power is held partially by a central authority and partially by a number of regional or state governments. Democratic decentralization of educational administrative organization has been one of the major reforms that have affected the country after the advent of democracy. Centralization is not considered to be compatible with the democratic ideals. Decentralization facilitates more of popular participation in the national development activities. Decentralization means transfer of power, responsibility and authority to the people at large. Democratic decentralization of educational administration means that schools must become the concern of the community if they want to become the part of national development. Our educational institutions should belong to the community, should be governed by the community, and should be managed by the community. The system of education must provide relationship of forces from village school to the university. It is the diffusion of power into the hands of people. The implications of democratic decentralization of educational administration expounded by several educationists reveal the importance of it, as it facilitates active participation in the institutional activities. It is meant to safeguard educational function from being misused through the control of higher authorities. However, as is the case with any new adventure, some defects have been found in the actual implementation. Many research studies have discussed various aspects of decentralization of educational administration. Latest trend is to apply six-tier Panchayat Raj educational administration to improve the system by removing the defects intelligently to reap more benefits from the system. Thank you.